Hey guys, this has been an incredible week. On Tuesday, I had Matt Ridley, who was a repeat guest. And then yesterday, I had Eric Topol, one of the most cited scientists alive today, over 200,000 citations, an H index of 200 and something. I mean, numbers that are not even human. And then to end the week, certainly last but not least, we have the second three-peat guest. The first three-peat guest was Dave Rubin, and now we have Michael Shermer for the third time back. How you doing, Michael?
The returning champion.
The returning champion.
Yeah, Matt Ridley, his book is really interesting, and I just read it. And a good timing on the innovation of vaccines. We could use that right now.
No kidding, no kidding. Yeah, no, we had a great chat. He's such a lovely guy, such an affable guy. Well, I always tell people that, I just love so much that I have this platform where I really feel like I'm a kid in a candy store. I'm giddy as I, count down the time to each of the conversations I'm going to have, because in a sense, that's what a real intellectual life should be like, right? You're surrounded by all sorts of super cool people that if you can't invite over for dinner, then at least you can do these Skype chats. So this is fantastic, right?
Yeah, no, I'm rather thriving in social isolation because most of what I do, like you, is done in isolation anyway, just reading and writing and researching, and in my case, riding my bike. All this is mostly done by myself. And when I ride, I listen to audiobooks, which is why I kind of started my podcast, just because I'm reading all these books anyway. That I'd like to talk to the people about. And I was, since 1992, we had been doing public lectures where I'd host the authors that would come to LA at Caltech. But that's a big pain in the neck, for an author to schlep their atoms across the country or wherever. And you have to then announce it, and then people have to drive to Caltech and park and go to the roof. Here, there's no atoms moving anywhere. You could sit and watch it from anywhere. And it's virtually free, and you can still sell books via Amazon.
Of course.
Yeah, the technology is really great. I'm curious to know what you think about this, but in the academic world, I think a lot of things could get shaken down
Oh,
here
yeah.
because, just the exchange of knowledge from one skull to another. Professor yammering at the chalkboard for an hour and a half. Why do students need to pay $50,000 a year for that?
Oh, I've been sort of circling around this idea for quite a while, and certainly through all of my public engagement, it became clear to me that, you and I exist in a currency of mimetic, transfer, right? I mean, we create knowledge, or certainly I have to as a professor. I've got to publish the peer-reviewed papers and so on, which is great. That's part of my job. But I also have to spread that knowledge, communicate that knowledge. Of course, I can do it through the peer-reviewed journals. I could do it through academic conferences. But I could also get on Joe Rogan and have 10 million downloads. I could speak to Michael Shermer and get a huge. And so I became intoxicated with the idea of the velocity at which we could spread knowledge. I could either have a classroom of seven super bright graduate students, physical students, which is great. I enjoy it. You create this little physical universe where ideas, or instead of seven people, it's 70,000 people. And so it's, and so, so for me, it's, th this has been sort of, festering in my mind about the notion of creating maybe not online universities, but sort of a greatminds.com series. I actually had pitched it to Google when they invited me to do a talks at Google. And they certainly were very interested in the idea. The idea that now with at your fingertips, you can get the top classicists to speak to you, the top historian of science, the top evolutionary psychologist, they're all there available to learn from. So I truly, well, what do you think? Do you think that this
Yeah,
COVID is
well,
going?
that's already in place. The teaching company and their great courses,
Yeah.
they do that. Although what they've just made the transition to a subscription format, so they have their the app you can download, which is free, of course. The Great Courses Plus, and there instead of buying a single course, like you want to take Calculus 101, it's $256. You download all the lecture files, 24 files, and you listen to them
Yep.
one by one. Forget that noise. Now you can just get the app, pay 15 bucks a month or whatever, and you have 5,000 courses to choose
It's
from. All
amazing.
of the lectures are available. And if you get bored with, lecture three, well, the hell with that. I'm going to go take this course on George Orwell. I just took this course on George Orwell.
Yeah.
It was incredible. But I only listened to maybe three quarters of the lectures. I got kind of bored with some of the stuff, so I switched to this other course about prepping for disasters and pandemics. I thought, well, that's a good time to take something like this. And I listened to maybe 6 or 7 of the 24 lectures, and then I skipped to another course. So all this is already there and available, and those courses are taught by the best professors in the field and so on. So I think there's going to be a market for more of that. I've been recording all my lectures for my Chapman course and uploading them. Steve Pinker did the same for his course on rationality at Harvard. You can take Steve Pinker's course on rationality at Harvard for free. You right. don't have to pay Harvard $50,000.
So does it basically amount to simply the fact that you need the credentials and that's what you end up paying for? Because the knowledge is there, as you said, and it's freely available. Yeah. I could take Robert Sapolsky's lectures at Stanford and I'm fully right. learning everything, but I right. need that Stanford in the back of my, on my wall, right? So yeah. is that ultimately what
yeah, that's part of it. Although I guess there's a social aspect to the college experience. You can't replace that. Small seminars, maybe lab courses, in biochemistry or I don't know what, microbiology. Maybe you need to be in the lab with the equipment and the professor. Maybe that can't be replaced. But surely the, you've probably seen those studies where you look at the rising costs of goods and services for the last 50 years. And economists take this little, a basket of goods, a quarter of milk, a loaf of bread, yeah. a gallon of gas, and so on. And you track them over time and you see they go up, a little bit, adjust for inflation. But the, university education is just like orders of magnitude fast, increasing faster, but not the ratio of professors to students. That's largely stayed the same since the 70s. Yeah. It's the administration, those deans of diversity, and I don't even know what they do. and they all draw big salaries, and presumably they have health care and retirement programs and all the insurance stuff, and that's expensive.
Yeah, no kidding. Mark Perry, the economist, University of Michigan, who's been on my show pretty recently, has an analysis of exactly what you just mentioned, the sort of the what I call them the DEI czars, the diversity, inclusion, and equity czars, right? Mm-hmm. And I think it's something in the order of, the top person, the top administrator of the DEI religion, I think has a salary of something like $393,000. You can have 4 full-time tenure track professors for what this person does. And that person only exists to cause pain, to cause division, right? There is zero literally, right? I see it in my, own life as a professor. So at one point I held a chaired professorship for 10 years, the chair was the first ever in evolutionary behavioral sciences and Darwinian consumption. I held it from 2008 to 2018. And at one point, I would be spending half my time filling out progress reports. So progress report to the dean of the business school, progress report to the provost, progress. So in my inimitable GAD style, which sometimes makes me friends, other times makes me enemies because I speak straight. I said, why don't I submit to you guys a progress report every day? In the morning, I'll work. And then from noon till 5, I just fill out a progress report of what I did. And guess what? They actually, I don't know if it was because of what I said, but they ended up sort of coalescing all these different progress reports into one file. But for many years, I was probably spending, 20, 30, 40 hours doing nothing but paperwork.
Unbelievable. Yeah, so that's one industry that might change a little bit because of the pandemic. I was also thinking about theaters. One of my cycling buddies owns a property development guy. And, of course, the guy, the theater company that rents his building for their theater, they can't pay their rent. And it's like $93,000 a month. So he had to go to his bank going, I can't make my mortgage because my guys aren't paying me any money. You get this trickle down. But he's worried that maybe the theaters are never going to reopen because why do you have to go to a big building and sit in a room full of people to watch a movie when the home are huge and beautiful and high def and you can stream anything you want right. practically for free and you can still have popcorn at home.
True. You're slightly patchy right now. You're breaking, so I hope it won't last long. I heard most of what you said, so hopefully let's keep going. Otherwise, we'll get that router okay. that you were talking about.
Okay.
So earlier you mentioned the books. Now, it seems as though roughly every 4 days you come out with a book. I think you came out with a book last Tuesday, and now we're here to discuss your next book. We'll hold another chat.
The latest.
I know, I'm going to hold it. I'm going to hold it for you. And so this is your latest book, your second one this week, I think. Giving the Devil His Due. I must admit, I haven't read it yet. I perused through, you know, the essays and the titles and so on. So why don't we talk about it for however long we want, and then we can move on to
other
topics.
No, that's great. I appreciate that. Now, it does seem like a lot. I've had 13 books, but remember, I'm 65 now, and I've been writing since my 20s. And four of the 13 are essay collections, which this one is. So that doesn't really quite count because I've already did the work.
Right.
You know, for individual articles, and you know how that works. So it takes me, you know, about 3 years per book, every 3 years.
That's your rhythm?
That's kind of the rhythm, yeah. And for me, I enjoy the process of researching and writing. It's, to me, it's a little bit like riding my bike. If I don't do it every day, I feel anxious, like, ooh, I really want to get to it. So it's not like writer's block that I have to, you know, grind through some 3 hours a day or something and I hate it. No. I look forward to it, and I consider it a challenge. So for me, that's kind of fun. And then I try to pick subjects that I think that, A, I'm super interested in and that I want to spend 3 years on, and B, that I think are important. You know, part of my life's work is to, you know, promote science and critical thinking and reason and try to understand how the world works and to make the world a better place. And you do that by solving problems. So, you know, first I start off with science and pseudoscience, and science and religion, science and morality, you know, now, you know, science and free speech and politics and whatnot, just kind of bouncing around to see to what extent I can apply the methods of science and reason to social problems, many of which have traditionally not been tackled by scientists. As you know, there's always been this kind of two culture with the wall and this, you know, technically, you know, Hume's, you know, wall separating facts from values, science from morality, and the naturalistic fallacy, all that stuff, you know. And I just think, and religion's kind of had a monopoly on, you know, meaning and morality and purpose in life. And, you know, most scientists sign off on Stephen Jay Gould's non-overlapping magisteria, yeah. NOMA. And I knew Steve was a good friend. I loved his strategy of trying not to have a war with religion. In the same way, because he was friends with Sagan, and Sagan felt like if we're going to solve global problems, we need the Christians, we need the Jews, we need the Muslims on our to embrace science. So he tried to take a more conciliatory approach, which, you know, I understand. But really, why would you leave the biggest, most interesting, important questions to the theologians?
Right.
You know, and as Dawkins jokes, you know, why not leave it to the plumbers? I mean, why the theologians?
Because, you know, they have the revealed truths, right?
Yeah, well, I think, yeah, well, of course, that's what they think. Although the thoughtful ones don't think that, you know, they're just using philosophy and reason. Well, why can't scientists do that? Because it's all part of the same thing, you know. So anyway, this book, Giving the Devil His Due, is, you know, kind of addressing the problem of free speech and free thought, in as much as in my lifetime, there's been this bizarre reversal where it used to be liberals who defended free speech and conservatives who were censorious and trying to squelch, you know, rock song lyrics because these were satanic and destroying the moral fabric of America, and Madonna's videos were corrupting the youth and, you know, those sorts of things. And you see these great videos from the 90s of Frank Zappa defending free speech, you know, and then against these conservative senators. Now, you know, you tune on Fox News and it's Sean, you know, Sean Hannity and Tucker Carlson defending free speech. It's like, what? Right. And then you go to college campuses and all these liberal professors are saying, no, we must censor people because of hate speech. I'm like, whoa, something bizarre happened in the last couple of decades.
It's a perfect segue to my next question. I know that Richard Dawkins is a good friend of yours, and I'm a big admirer of his. So I have nothing but respect for his public engagement and for his scientific work and so on. But today he put out a tweet, which I went after him. I did it in as polite a way as I could, as restrained a way as I could. I put out a sad truth where I challenged his position. It was basically his support for Twitter's new fact-checking algorithm. And I thought that it was a breathtakingly bad idea. Now, I can't pretend to know what drove him to take this position, but I think I could, with pretty great accuracy, predict what it was. It dealt with the fact that he's got massive Trump derangement syndrome. These particular fact-checking tweets dealt with Trump tweets, and therefore he loses his commitment to free speech absolutism by saying, well, what's wrong with fact-checking? To which I then started explaining, well, I think that there is no greater murder of truth than Holocaust deniers. I am Jewish and I support their right to spew their bullshit. And as a matter of fact, I think you have an essay in your book that deals with this issue. So how, well, first of all, I'm not asking you to speak on behalf of Richard Dawkins, but how do you explain supposedly, you know, extremely sophisticated people who, I mean, Sam Harris also thinks that, you know, Donald Trump should be booted off Twitter. I mean, it's insane, right?
Yeah.
So how do you explain this? I mean, you know both of them well. I mean, I know them too, but not as well as you do. Whether you speak about them or generally intellectuals who could be parasitized by bad ideas, maybe you could comment on that.
Yeah, I think in general, of course, Sam and Richard are committed to fact and fact checking, and you know the rise since 2016 of sites like PolitiFact and Snopes and others that fact check say speeches in real time. I think that's a useful tool. That's my response to, well, we should censor these people. No, just fact check them and have a whole other site. The problem with the social media is that they've kind of bounced around between being publishers and platforms. So if you're a publisher like the New York Times or a book publisher, of course you're censoring, screening people all the time. You don't just publish anything anybody sends you. So they can be held liable for publishing, say, an article that libels somebody in print, and because they had a chance to fact check it and so forth. But if you're a platform in which, say, a public park, you know, the local county government can't be responsible for every nut job that stands in the corner of Hyde Park and shouts his crazy ideas. And so, in a way, the social media platforms are at this critical moment, like the moment they go down the road of what you just described, like we're going to start screening people and flagging them or fact checking them or even taking their posts off the site entirely, like YouTube flags certain videos, like some of yours, I guess, or demonetizes them or whatever they do. Now they're starting to act like publishers who are censoring in the normal traditional way, which is fine. They're screening, or call it whatever you want. They're being discriminating like any publisher is, but then they don't want to be held accountable. They want to say, but we're just a platform and anybody can say whatever they want. So this is the problem. And I didn't see Richard's tweets. I'm sure some of that is the anti-Trump. He and Sam hate Trump quite a bit. It would be curious to know if they'd feel the same way if it was, I don't know, a Joe Biden tweet.
I'll give you a specific one. Here's one. There is the Nobel prophet, Barack Obama, went up in front of the United Nations and said, the future must not belong to those who slander the prophet of Islam. Now, it's almost impossible for me to think of something. Oh, yeah, he did. Look it up. So it's almost impossible for me to think of something more injurious to free societies than that statement. Yet I didn't call for him to be fact-checked, to be censored, I mock him, I deride him, I attack his ideas. Hopefully my ideas beat out his. But yet, someone like Sam, whom I admire greatly, someone like Richard, whom I admire greatly, lose all of their measure, all of their nuance, because bruh, Orange Man Bad is really, really nasty. So we can throw away all these first principles because we can put that but clause. I believe in freedom of speech, but Trump.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
And so it in a sense, I find it very disheartening. But in a sense, it goes well with my forthcoming book, which basically argues that no one is necessarily immune from being parasitized by idea pathogens. The fact that you are a smart person doesn't mean you are inoculated. And I think they're living proof of that. And again, I don't mean it to be disrespectful to them, but it really pisses me off because I support the right of Holocaust deniers to say the Holocaust never happened. I support the right of Islamic extremists to say that Jews were loved in Lebanon. I escaped execution in Lebanon. So if I am such a free speech absolutist, then certainly you can be enough generous, Richard and Sam, to allow the president of the United States to spew any bullshit he wants on a social media platform.
Yep, I'm with you on that 100%.
Thank you.
The chapter you referenced in the book is on David Irving.
Exactly.
And I defended him, even though I've debunked him. I think he's wrong. Maybe he's even an anti-Semite or whatever. I don't know what's in his heart, but it doesn't look good. But nevertheless, when he went to Austria, he was arrested at the airport. They scanned his passport and it came up, oh, this is David Irving. This is that guy. He's a Holocaust denier. And that's illegal in Austria, Germany, France, in Canada, New Zealand, Australia. Illegal. I mean, and here so he was going to Austria to give a speech. It just probably a small hotel room with 20 people or something. It's nothing. But he didn't even speak. He was just thinking of giving a speech. So in a way, it's a kind of arrested for a thought crime. And he was tried and convicted and sent to jail. So I wrote a letter to the judge on his behalf saying, this is unacceptable. And I can't stand this guy. I think he's totally wrong. But let him say whatever he wants, because, who's going to believe it once he's debunked? Maybe a few. But so what? That's as extreme as it gets for me. By that example, and still you have to stick by that principle. And the problem is, as I show in the first chapter of the book, is the moment you go down that pathway of saying, well, okay, we're going to screen some people, we're going to censor some. Okay, who? And who decides? What's the criteria? And you set up a committee, language police. It just sets up a really bad precedent.
Well, and usually the things that they are so-called fact-checking is not whether Paris is the capital of France or whether the number 7 is a prime number. They're usually fact-checking rather contentious issues that probably reasonable people on both sides of the aisle could have valid arguments for or against, right? And so I actually... one of the strategies I use is I use sarcasm and satire to make points. So I started putting out a whole bunch of tweets today to the dear Twitter Ministry of Truth. I'd like to make sure that I'm on the right side of truth. So would I be correct in stating that there are two phenotypes, male or female, in Homo sapiens? Or is the correct statement to say that there are 873 genders? Now, in doing that, not only am I mocking the idiocy of that fact-checking, gulag stuff, but I'm also then attacking the trans activism lunacy where in the quest to protect trans people, which of course you and I would support, we have to murder the truth and deny reality. No, there aren't 873 genders. No, biological sex is not on a continuum, right? Yes, of course there are intersex people. And yes, of course they should be granted to live free lives free of bigotry. But there is a thing called two phenotypes in a sexually reproducing species. And it shouldn't take me to appear in front of the Canadian Senate to prove to the senators, no, really, I mean it. There is such a thing as male or female. So, it's insane, right? At one point, do you think some of these, what I call idea pathogens, do you think will be auto-corrected? Do you think we're in for a long haul of lunacy, or do you see it turning around the tide?
Yeah, my wife's been having this conversation with me because our son is 4, and so in 10 years he's going to be, in junior high, and then in 15 years he's going to be in college, and she's worried that insanity is going to be still continuing. I keep telling her, no, we're just about to turn the corner.
Gatside is on the case.
That's right. And about every 6 months, she says, she reminds me, well, where's that corner? So we haven't turned it yet. Every time there's a crazy story. Usually Tucker Carlson has his Campus Craziness Weekly segment. And, if you only watch that, you'd think, college campuses were falling apart. But it does look pretty bad. I don't know where we are in the process. I am encouraged by groups like the Heterodox Academy that now has thousands of professors that are pushing back. Not just a handful that you can name, but thousands and thousands. So that's good. The analogy I use, since you're in Canada, is with the Holocaust denial thing, because it's illegal in Canada, is let's say there is a legitimate debate about how many Native Americans have died since Columbus first came here. 1492. And it isn't clear how many Native Americans were here before. Like it might have been 90 million, 100 million, 50 million, you know, somewhere in that range. And maybe 90% of them died, mostly of germs, but, you know, some of guns and steel. But let's say I come along and I say, you know what, I really think it was more like 5 to 10 million, not 50 million, like, an, you know, just a whole order of magnitude less. Does that make me a Holocaust denier, that I'm denying the genocide of the Native Americans? Well, I mean, come on. There has to be a space for, you know, for skepticism of anything. You know, and who cares what my motives are? You don't know what's in somebody's heart. Well, you're just a racist. And that's not a counter argument.
Well, incidentally, the indigenization process, something that I discuss at some length in my forthcoming book, is completely on steroids now in Canada. So I've been trying to be polite and not commenting too much about what I'm about to mention now, because it's actually happened at my own university, and out of respect for my institution, I've been restraining myself. But some folks at my university recently won a big government grant to indigenize physics.
What?
Let me repeat that. To indigenize physics. Okay?
Okay.
So in the same, you know, from one side of the mouth, one university in Montreal, a major university, is indigenizing physics. At the other side, at the other street, with another major university, a professor in the natural sciences, whom I know personally, who wrote me about his trials and tribulations. I actually did a sad truth on his or her case. I don't want to say if it's a male or female. Well, that person was denied. This is a person in hardcore natural sciences, was denied a grant because the diversity, inclusion, and equity statement was not up to par. The person didn't show how they were going to create a diverse and inclusive environment. So that person doesn't win a grant in the natural sciences because he or she failed on the die metrics. And on the same hand, there's indigenization of the natural sciences. So, I mean, even my satire is probably unable, well, actually it is capable of coming up with stuff like that, because oftentimes my satire proves to be prophetic, because I try to think, yes, what would be the most incredibly ludicrous thing that could happen. So, for example, about 3-4 years ago, I announced to the world that I had founded a new discipline called social justice mathematics. So, for example, irrational numbers, is it inappropriate to say irrational, because then you are marginalizing mental health issues and so on. And it was completely, you know, satire. Well, guess what? Now we have that social justice where mathematics is racist. It's white logic and so on. So we're in for
That's
a long
crazy.
Ride.
Is this a little bit like that feminist glaciology?
Exactly. That's actually also my forthcoming book. There is feminist epistemology. There is now a thing called neurosexism. The idea being that when you conduct studies on anatomical features of the brain, right, what they basically end up doing is they look for a million different markers. And once they find, if they find, for example, one where the male brain is not different from the female brain, that proves that there is no such thing that as a male brain or a female brain, to which I usually satirize. I say, well, this is why we're getting a giraffe as a pet rather than a dog, because we can't tell the difference, because both a giraffe and a dog have a tail. Both a giraffe and a dog have two ears. Therefore, they're the same species. They're indistinguishable, right? So, but this is the lunacy. Now, this is promoted in nature, right? This is not a quack right. feminist epistemology, journal. This is in nature, where people are now arguing that it is sexist to argue that there are fundamental differences, whether it be morphological, hormonal, anatomical differences in male and female brains. It's insane.
Yeah. Yeah, you might be right. We might be in for the long haul pushing back against this. I remember when our mutual friend Pete did the fake papers, the faux papers on what was it, the conceptual penis, and then the others, you know, the rate of dog parks, and anyway, you know, he was pretty confident that this was really going to shut down these journals, like they would just go out of business. And I thought, I don't think so. I they have a lot of momentum, and there's a lot of sort of interior structure at universities that people outside in the real world, they don't know about or care about. So they'll probably just keep going. And as far as I know, they are still going.
I actually warned him of the exact same thing, because he was very excited that he was going to put, you know, this fatal blow to all these disciplines. They were going to disappear once this grand project was going to be revealed. And I said, I don't think so. Now, I think there's also a built-in mechanism in these bullshit disciplines to protect against what Pete and his colleagues did, which is, who are you to judge what meaning is? I mean, that's exactly what happened with the SoCal paper, right? Even when SoCal comes out and says, hey, it was all a hoax, that didn't stop them from saying, but hey, in hermeneutics, we could, even though you wrote what seemed like gibberish, we inferred meaning from it, and therefore it is perfectly valid. So you didn't prove anything, Dr. SoCal, right?
Right, right. Yeah, I think that was the response. And in a way that, in their worldview, that does sort of make sense. There is no real truth, or even not even a small t truth that science can get at. It's all about power, really. You know, I think if we try to look at the historical origins of this movement, I think it really goes back to the deplorable racist scientific theories of the 19th century that were debunked. And in a way, it's sort of pushing back against an enemy that's no longer around, that, you know, science debunked. And but ironically, it's embracing the same strategy of cataloging or categorizing people by race, by gender. Like, I don't care what your ideas are. I care about what your skin color is, or what, you know, what gender you are, if there is such a thing. And therefore, that's really what the 19th century people they're criticizing were doing.
Yeah.
You know, so it's again, another one of these monstrous reversals of Dr. King's dream of, you know, content of their character, not the color of their skin. You know, I think he'd be spinning in his grave right now about this. You know, this is not what I had in mind. I meant, quit talking about race. Quit it.
Well, I think it's what this demonstrates is that the notion of forbidden knowledge in academia should never exist, because it is the perfect manifestation of the slippery slope argument, right? Now, if you look at, for example, the cultural relativists, the original guys who argued that there is no biological mechanisms when it comes to human behavior, it's all culture specific and so on. Well, it started with Franz Boas, the cultural anthropologist, and then moved on to all of his students, all of whom were complete bullshitters. Oh, there is no such thing as sex differences when it comes to mating behavior, hence the fateful hoaxing of Margaret Mead and so on. Well, in a sense, that started from a very, quote, noble place, right? Precisely because of what you said, because there were this misapplication of Darwinian theory by a whole range of cretins, well, let's now murder truth by denying that biology matters to the human condition, because then we could protect against future cretins. But in the pursuit of justice, you can't kill truth, right?
There's a chapter title of your next book.
Exactly right. I was like, God damn, that sounded good.
It sounds good. Yeah, so I think, like, if we go back to the, you know, the political correctness thing, and I think if you think, you know, maybe 1950s or 60s or so, when this starts to gain momentum as part of the civil rights movement, you know, don't use the N-word. Don't call women the C-word. Don't call Jews kikes. Don't call Asians gooks and so on. You know, I'm okay with that. It's like, yeah, okay, I don't use those words, and it's better we don't, because, you know, they are hurtful. But the moment you say, and we're going to make a list, and this is the list of words and phrases, and we're going to censor you if you use them. Well, first of all, mission creep sets in. The basket of words gets bigger and bigger. I reprinted Giving the Devil His Due, that the document sent out to the University of California. All students, all faculty, administration, so on. You know, it's like 500,000 people or so of microaggressions. You know, it goes on for pages and pages. You know, if I say, where are you from? This is allegedly offensive, you know, because it implies that you're not a normal American or Canadian, where you must be from somewhere else. Or, wow, you speak English so well. Now, this is a funny one, because this implies they're foreigners, and therefore they're strangers in a strange land, and they're not properly, whatever. Well, this is funny for me, because my wife's German and she speaks perfect English. Her English is actually better than most Americans' English. And so when people find out she's from Germany, they go, wow, you speak English so well. And so she, instead of being offended, she says, "Well, thank you. I paid attention in school." And it's a, but the problem is the moment you set up some committee to write this list, you know, then somebody's got to sit there and go, okay, well, what might anybody anywhere find offensive? And that list is just going to grow. And so that's the problem. It starts off with a noble idea. Don't use the N-word. Okay, I'm not going to use the N-word. I see why that's offensive. Okay, now let's find some more words. And then boom, 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 boom. Before you know it, you have a 15-page document with hundreds and hundreds of things you can't say. Now, even if, let's say, the university or much less the government doesn't directly censor people, what it does is causes people to self-censor.
Of course.
You know, so when I ask my students, how many of you self-censor about ideas, you know, like about race or race and intelligence or immigration or abortion, or whatever, they all raise their hand. Of course, I'm not going to, I almost never say what I think. You're in college. This is the time you should be saying everything you're thinking. And, you know, we knock down half your ideas are crazy, whatever. That's okay. This is the time to learn. So that's the problem. I opened Giving the Devil His Due in 1919. So this is where it all begins, at least in the United States, with the famous Schenck versus the United States case. So Charles Schenck was the head of the Socialist Party of Philadelphia. And in 1917, he started issuing or distributing flyers to draft age men, telling them, don't go to war. This is when the United States was ramping up to enter the First World War. And he said, you know, conscription, the draft, this is unconstitutional. This violation of the 13th Amendment, which prohibits slavery, and the 14th Amendment, which guarantees your right to bodily autonomy. Because in a way, when the government says, you have to go into the army, you have to go to war, they're enslaving you for 2 or 4 years or whatever. They're saying, we control your body. You may die. Too bad. In the national interest, that's what we're doing. Okay, so now maybe you want to debate that, but my point is that that can't be debated. He was arrested for this, for treason. This is so on appeal to the U.S. Supreme Court, Supreme Court Justice Oliver Wendell Holmes issued his now famous statement, the most stringent protection of free speech would not protect a man in falsely shouting fire in a theater and causing a panic. The question in every case is whether the words used are used in such circumstances and are of such a nature as to create a clear and present danger that they will bring about the substantive evils that Congress has a right to prevent. So there's that phrase, clear right. and present danger. That's where it comes from. And the analogy of the falsely shouting fire in a theater. Okay, so the moment you set that up, and Holmes later regretted he did that because the category got big. Like, everything is a clear and present danger. Anybody who says something I don't like, if I'm a politician, that's a clear and present danger to our nation. We have to stop them. And that's exactly what happened. So he backed off a little bit, but we've been, you know, that momentum carried through. It's like, you know, the U.S. Supreme Court justice statement, you know, decision, that's precedence. And so by the time you get to the Vietnam War, then, you know, protesting the draft became a big thing and burning the American flag and like, oh, no, clear and present danger, clear and present danger. All the way up to today where, you know, everything is conceivably a clear and present danger.
Well, which, by the way, goes back to my point earlier. By the way, I should really apologize. You're extremely grainy in the thing, but I mean, it doesn't matter. I think I can hear you perfectly. So hopefully we won't be receiving a thousand comments about, you know, how bad we are and evil and so on. But actually, you're a bit better now. So maybe it's a question of you moving or not.
I'm moving around too much.
Yep. I think that's what it is. I think that's what it is. Because now I can see you a lot better. So this goes back actually exactly to the point that I made earlier about Sam and Richard, because in their case, clear and present danger is called orange man bad, right? So yes, of course I support freedom of speech, but this guy is so evil, this guy is so monstrous, he is so close to ending civilization that I'm willing to forego these first principles about freedom of speech because he is a clear and present danger. And I would love to actually sit down with him, and maybe at some point I will, and actually say, I mean, do you not see the irony of this position? Do you not see the contradiction? But I'm willing to bet that they would say no. They would say, in this particular case, this guy is so bad, he is no different from Hitler. You certainly wouldn't feel bad about stopping Hitler from spewing his shit. So why can't you stop Donald Trump? How can we get these types of folks to understand their inconsistencies? Or can you?
Yeah. Well, you can make a GadSad video and do what you do. I think it is helpful. You have a big enough platform. I think you can, and that's all we can do. All of us can do, because that's our principle of free speech, right? You
Exactly.
just I'm not saying you should be censored for doing that, but here's my criticism of you. I think that's the best thing we can do. I'm old enough to remember these kinds of claims made against Nixon, for example, who famously hated the media. And now we have those audio tapes that we didn't know about at the time, where he's going on and on about the media is being run by those Jews and so on. It's like, hey, boy. And he was just as nasty to the press as Trump is. When Goldwater was running, there was that group of psychiatrists who diagnosed him as, whatever the clinical diagnosis was at the time. And this has a long tradition of doing this, and I think it's a bad precedent.
Well,
And the country always survives anyway.
I had a friend. I don't want to turn this into a Trump derangement, discussion, but just one more story, because it really speaks to how people who are perfectly rational can completely become obsessed with their tribalism. And I mentioned this somewhere. I can't remember where on social media, but a gentleman wrote to me, who is an otherwise well-respected person. I mean, he's not an academic, but he's a sharp guy, older gentleman. And he said, "I really respect your opinion, Professor. Could you please read this article and give me your opinion?" I said, "Okay, fine." So it was an article written in Salon by a clinical psychologist who was basically arguing that the deaths that we're seeing due to COVID in the United States stem from the sexual sadism of Donald Trump. He gets such sexual gratification at the idea of causing harm that, that's basically what's happening. Which then I satirized by, I don't know if you've seen my series where I hide under my table because I am
Yes,
so
I
afraid.
know.
And so I did one of these clips. Now, this person who otherwise I think is, in his 60s, is a reasonable person, wasn't able to, off the top of his, just look at this and laugh at it. He genuinely thought that there might be something valuable to the idea that Donald Trump is causing the death of 100,000 people in the United States because it might help him masturbate better.
Oh my God.
I mean,
All right.
this is
Yeah.
published in Salon. It's by a clinical
Yeah.
psychologist. I went to check the clinical psychologist. It wasn't from a diploma mill that he got his PhD. He's a real
Right.
guy. So every day, in a sense, I wake up both excited at the prospects of the day, but also disheartened by the lunacy that's going to befall me and that I'm going to have to try to squash, right? Because if the clinical psychologist is willing to make the argument that sexual sadism, actually, and it's called democide, it is the genocidal killing of 100,000 people through the tools of democracy. I mean,
Oh my God,
what
that's
I would have
crazy.
done is I would have taken that clinical psychologist and committed him to a psychiatric institute for writing that article. That would have been my thing, right?
Yeah.
So how do
Now,
we
why do you suppose Salon publish something like that? That's.
you're being
I don't know. I
yeah,
mean, I
well,
haven't looked at Salon in a while, but they were pretty far out there for a
yeah.
while.
Okay, I wanted to ask you next to come back to. Let me plug it in again. Here's the latest book by Michael. In your last chapter, or not last chapter, the last section, you talk about transcendent and controversial intellectuals. Now, if it were only transcendent intellectuals, then I would have a beef with you as to why I am not the first guy in that section. But because you mentioned controversial, I don't think I'm controversial, so I'm willing to give you a pass for why I wasn't included. So the five people who are in that section, now everybody will get my humor, but there'll be some hater who'll now create a Reddit thread about my narcissism because he can't detect humor. But anyways, so the five, let me mention them, and then maybe we could talk about any of them, all of them. Paul Kurtz, by the way, you may not know this, you probably know that he was the founder of Prometheus Books. My last book, The Consuming Instinct, was with Prometheus Books, so a great little boutique publisher. Christopher Hitchens, of course, Richard Dawkins, Jordan Peterson. Now, Graham Hancock, the only thing I know about him is that you've had debates with him on Joe Rogan. So which one do you want to take? Do you want to tackle all of them?
Well, I think the last two, I think Jordan Peterson, Graham Hancock are the most interesting of that section because in a way they test my free commitment to free speech and heterodox thinking, viewpoint diversity, and so on. Because we'll just take Graham Hancock. Now, he's not an archaeologist. He's not a scientist. He's a journalist. He's a writer. He's a great writer. He's what's called an alternative archaeologist. Now, he doesn't think aliens built the pyramids, not that kind of alternative, but that there was a super advanced civilization that existed tens of thousands of years before what we think of as the oldest civilizations, Mesopotamia, Babylonia, and so on. Now, his evidence for this is all in the form of sort of negative evidence. Scientists can't explain these anomalies here, 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 and here. I think these are evidences of this advanced civilization. Okay. Now, most archaeologists ignore someone like him, but I don't. This is what I do. I engage the people that are on the margins for two reasons. One, I'm interested in it. Two, they might be right or partially right, and I don't want to be so dogmatically committed to orthodox science that we close our minds off to outsiders, because sometimes outsiders do make contributions. So when Joe had us on, Joe likes people like Graham, and he's super open to it, even more than quite a bit more than me. So he had me on as sort of the voice of orthodox science. So I kind of played that role, and I got hammered for that. Like Shermer's he's a flatlander, he's a dogmatist, he's just one of those scientism guys that think out of the box and so on. Anyway, so I got pushback for just doing that. But I got to know Graham after that, and I read more of his books, and I thought, okay, I think this guy's probably wrong, but he has enough interesting points that I think it's worth it for archaeologists to take him seriously. He's a good writer. Read his books, you listen to him on audio, it's even better because he reads them and he has a British accent. And, that bumps up the value of any argument for Americans by at least 10 points. So I think, in terms of why should we listen to these other people? So that gets back to the first chapter where I kind of rehash John Stuart Mill's arguments on liberty. You might be wrong. You might be partially wrong. You might be completely right, but not knowing what the other side argues, you don't even really know your own argument. He who knows only his own side of the story doesn't even know that. My example for students, most of my students are liberal. Most of them are pro-choice. When we talk about abortion, I say, what's the best argument on the pro-life side? Most of them, they have no idea. They don't even know what pro-lifers are. Oh, they just hate women. It's like, no, that's not an argument. It's not what they're saying, right? And I have them watch a Ben Shapiro video where he, gets a pretty, boisterous argument in defense of pro-life. And it's like, oh, okay. Now, can you rebut that? Now, I happen to think he's wrong, but if you can't rebut his arguments, if you don't have a counter argument, then how good is your pro-choice position really? Okay, so I kind of go through that, and that's my argument to archaeologists. Okay, now we can't engage every single alternative archaeologist, the aliens built the pyramids people. Okay, I get that. But there has to be some room for outsiders, to have a say and give them a voice. Then Jordan Peterson I engaged in because, I met him really, first encountered him through your show and then Joe's show, and, he's been everywhere since. I think you were the first to put him on a social platform. And so I never heard of the guy, like most people, and I thought, this guy is really interesting. And, half the things he said, I thought, I don't know if I'm going down this pathway with him. But he's smart, thoughtful, he has integrity, he cares. He's trying to make an argument. I think people like that are worth listening to. But most people, as you know, they can't stand him. They won't read him. They won't listen to him. They just set up a straw man. But try to steel man Jordan Peterson. That's difficult to do.
Right.
So I try to do this in that last chapter. In as much as, he has this theory of truth, this sort of pragmatic evolutionary theory of truth. I'd love your opinion of that. And I thought, I don't quite go with that. But, it's an interesting take. It's worth thinking about. And it kind of pushes me like, okay, Shermer, how good is your theory of truth if you can't respond to this guy? Anyway, so I'd love your thoughts on.
Well, I think, what I would mention most is regarding certainly Jordan is that, as we're very good friends. And yet, as you also know, both publicly and privately in some of our conversations you and I have had, there's a lot of stuff that I disagree with him on. And I think what I love about that is that in no way have any of our public disagreements, you know, I'm not into his Jungian stuff, in any way affected the affection that we feel for one another, right? So I could say, I think this Jungian stuff is a bunch of quackery, right? I mean, I could try to do it in as nice a way as possible. Certainly when I'm speaking to him, I'm very respectful and I'm very warm and friendly. But this demonstrates a terribly important lesson in today's climate, which is people can truly disagree and walk away in no way harmed in their friendship. To be your friend is not to agree with you. On the contrary, it's precisely what defines strong friendships, which is they should be anti-fragile, right? I should be able to sit with Michael and say, you know what, Michael, I think what you just said is an utter piece of bullshit, okay? And then you go, no, and then we have a great time, and then we go off for a run. So I think more than anything, what I love in my you know, evolving relationship with Jordan is that we agree on many, many things. We disagree on a few. And in no case, whether we agree or disagree, does it affect the affection that we have for one another. Regarding the truth thing, yeah. I wish I could offer you a good position. I actually purposely stayed away from it. I had probably received a million requests to weigh in on the Sam Harris versus Jordan Peterson truth thing. And so at one point I tried to sit down, and after about 3 or 4 minutes, I almost committed suicide. And therefore I said, yeah, I need to maintain a healthy blood pressure. And so I never actually followed through. So I frankly don't know what the argument is. If you want to synthesize it for me and then I could offer a comment, I'd be happy to, whatever you want.
Yeah, no, let's not go down that path because it takes a long time to kind of deconstruct it. You know, on the Jungian stuff, yeah, I think that's mostly bullshit. But the idea that there are, say, deeper metaphorical truths or literary truths or something like that in a novel. Yes, I agree. Of course, whether, you know, that there were probably not brothers named Karamazov in revolutionary Russia in the 19th century is irrelevant. Of course, what it's a novel. It's like asking, but Harry Potter never existed, so I'm not going to take those arguments seriously. You know, literature has a role, and as you know, there's an evolutionary literary analysis field. Exactly. I forget what it's called, but
Darwinian literary criticism.
Yeah, and it's great. It's like, why do certain things come up in all the great novels? You know, love and sex and power and deception and, you know, standard, because that's human nature and that's what, you know, we care about. And so, you know, and so those are a kind of truth, I think, that touches on something that's real, even though the story is made up. You know, the theme behind it is true. So if that's what Jordan is arguing, then okay, I'm okay with that. I think he goes further than
he
that.
He does. That's the problem. See, he doesn't root it in a very earthly analysis, right? That so because people write to me and say, but professor, I mean, you talk about archetypes, right? Well, yes. But so, for example, you could analyze a romance novel, which is primarily consumed or read by women, where there is a identical same male hero in every single romance novel that's ever been written, right? He's tall, he's a count, he's also a surgeon, he wrestles alligators on his six-pack, he is reckless, but he could only be tamed by the love of this one good woman. It's literally like plagiarism. It's cut and paste the exact same archetype. Now, that archetype exists because it caters to female fantasies. Whether I am a Romanian woman or a Nigerian woman or a Japanese woman. Therefore, that archetype could be analyzed through an evolutionary lens, and it makes perfect sense. But it's not because booga booga and the tambours of the collective consciousness, right? So I don't need to couch it in booga booga language for it to make total sense. That's the problem with Jung.
Yeah. Yeah, that's right. I agree. And to the extent that Jordan goes down that path, then I think that's maybe problematic or an area of disagreement. And we can still be friends. Yeah, what happened to the idea you could still be friends? I think we become so politically polarized that it's not enough to say I disagree with you. You're not just wrong, but you're bad.
You're bad. You're evil.
And therefore,
you're...
I can't be friends with somebody who's immoral or evil.
Well, I get it usually, and now I'm not talking about friends, but from, say, fans, where, you know, I admired you and loved you so much, Dr. Saad, until, and then fill in the blank. So until yeah. you posted a photo of meat, you're a pig. How could you love dogs and eat meat? Until you didn't insult Trump, until you said that you are an evolutionist, so someone can literally send me a million emails of how much I've changed their life, but then that one time where I take a position that is contrary to theirs, the whole edifice of support and affection that they had for me goes out the wall, and I am literally Hitler. It's unbelievable. Impossible to even disagree on one position.
Yeah. I was thinking about this the other day as it's sort of an extension of the negativity bias. Yeah. You know, where bad is stronger than good. You know, like the one drop rule, or like, you know, a tub of honey in which you put one drop of feces or one, you know, just a tiny little bit, you know, corrupts the entire thing. One drop of black blood means you know, you're not pure white. Or, you know, in India, they have the caste system, and the right. one drop rule applies there. In a way, it's sort of an extension of that. Like a politician or a minister can have a life of public service and good works, and they have an affair, or they embezzle, or they right. do one thing that erases their entire career.
Yeah.
And in a way, we've gotten to that with just something like social media. You know, you post, you know, 8,000 tweets or whatever. I found one.
Yeah,
on
exactly.
one where you slipped up, and that erases the entire corpus of your work.
Well, that's the old cancel culture, right?
Yes.
That's the term now. Yeah.
That, another terrible idea.
Do you, as a result of that, do you ever, before you press the send button, stop and think? Or do you feel that you are sufficiently well calibrated that whatever you write, you think, ready to go?
No, I'm clueless. I'm an okay boomer, and I know I screw up. Sometimes I wait, and it's still a bad idea to send. Sometimes I ask my wife, which is the answer is almost always, don't send it. And she's probably usually right. I don't know. To me, it's an intractable thing, although I don't think I'm the only one that stumbles around and screws up on social media. I try not to read the comments because they're just so vile.
Yeah,
you know, I did this show last week on with Brian Rose called London Real, and he's become kind of a controversial figure.
Tell me the story, because I don't know what happened.
Well, he had David Icke on his show.
Oh, right.
Now he's kind of a Joe Rogan wannabe. Everybody wants to be Joe Rogan and have a huge audience like that. But you know, he has controversial figures and whatnot, and. But anyway, this David Icke guy, he's been around for a long time. We've encountered him many times because he has this idea about lizard aliens from this other planet are secretly living in New Mexico underground running the world. You know, it's kind of the short version of this, but I mean, he's way out there. Anyway, so he's sort of the Alex Jones of England.
Okay, got it.
He's got every crazy, every conspiracy. He's never met a conspiracy theory he didn't like. Right. So with COVID-19, he's all over, you know, it's 5G and, you know, the whole thing. So Brian has him on and just sort of uncritically listens to him. And it goes on for hours. And Icke is pretty articulate. And again, to American ears, a British accent in a relatively articulate way, explaining something. It's like, whoa, that actually sounds pretty good. Anyway, so he, you know, had me on not just for the book, but, you know, what did you think about David Icke? So I gave my opinion and I said, and by the way, I thought it was unfair that YouTube took that down, or whatever, they censored it in some way. I forget exactly what. And he had, yeah, that's right. I think they took it off the YouTube platform. So he reposted it on his own platform. And so I was defending him, saying, no, I don't think they should have done that. I mean, I think David Icke is out of his mind, but I think he should have a voice. What's wrong? Back to where we started this conversation. Yeah. And so in a way, it was kind of funny. I got criticized for just being on a show by, you know, liberals and progressives or whatever. And then I got criticized by his followers for debunking David Icke and the 5G. Shermer's an idiot. He's a shill for Big Pharma. It's like, dude, I'm defending your guy being on the show, saying whatever he wants. I mean, I don't have to agree with it. But
I've actually had a similar response from some fans because I had invited Deepak Chopra on the show. You know, he's a very lovely, warm individual. I mean, you know him very well. Now, of course,
I didn't see that one. I have to go back and watch that.
Oh, come on, man. Or what does Joe Biden say? Yeah, come on, man. That's it. Exactly. So I had Deepak on and people went wild. Like, you've sold out. This guy is a quack. You call yourself a man of science. And I was kind of baffled by this because Deepak has a very interesting life story. Whether you agree with some of his positions or not, you know, the quantum energy and so on, and I certainly, you know, don't subscribe to some of that stuff. He's an interesting guy, right? So if every single person with whom I have disagreements I don't invite, then I'm going to be talking to myself for most of the shows, right? But it's incredible the reflex that people had. I mean, this guy has had an incredibly successful career. He has a lot of interesting things to say. Some of it, I think, is you know, crazy. But a lot of it, I mean, his ability to market his ideas, right? As someone who studies marketing, I mean, he's a great salesman of his ideas. That's something worthy of learning about. So I agree with you. It's just amazing how, again, going back to our point, I agree with you until you say something that I disagree with, then you become Hitler, then you lose all legitimacy. I thought you were a real scientist. Now I know you're a bullshitter. You're a fraud. You're a scammer. And so it's a form of black or white thinking where you truly are unable to live in the grays, basically.
Some of it also is the kind of anonymity and distance that the internet provides that make it easy for people to be hostile and angry. You know, if you actually meet Deepak Chopra and get to know him, which I have, thanks in part mainly to my wife kind of pushing me, let's go down to his center. He invited us down. Let's go down there and spend a few days, you know, with him. And we did. And it's like, this guy he really cares. He's really trying to do the right thing.
Right.
And he wants to know truth and so on. And he has his ideas. They're different from mine, but you know, he's a good guy.
He is a good guy.
You know, if you just have the distance and, you know, just, it seems easy to criticize and just, he's a fraud.
Right.
No, I would not use that word. Not at all.
Yeah.
A small example of this is, you know, periodically I get really nasty letters, email or direct message on Twitter, whatever. And, sometimes I respond. I'll say something like, oh, gosh, I'm so sorry that what I wrote, you know, offended you. I didn't mean to. I was just trying to make this point. And they almost always respond like, oh, my God, I had no idea you were going to respond.
Right.
Holy crap. I'm sorry. I sounded so angry. I really love your work. It's just that one thing. And it's like, right, calm down.
Yeah, it's amazing.
The moment you make a personal contact, that changes everything.
Well, I don't want to jinx this, but I could tell you that while I would say 99% of all comments that I receive from people are incredibly positive. But of course, our brains, as you said earlier, the negativity bias, we only remember that 1%. But if I compare my online interactions, where I do have that 1% of bad interactions, but and 1% of a very big number is still something that weighs on you. But in face-to-face interactions, you know, I've had thousands of people come up to me. Not once, knock on wood, have I ever had someone be anything less than incredibly sweet and kind. So I don't know if it's because the numbers are such that I haven't met the assholes yet, or whether it's because people don't feel as comfortable being mean to you in person. But I've never, I can't ever say that I've had somebody come up to me. Now, what I've had is someone who doesn't have good social grace. So, for example, I'm sitting with my family. They come up. They take over. They start lecturing to me about their ideas. And I have to be polite. So I sit there while my family is around, while this person is lecturing to me. But they didn't mean to be mean. They were just excited to interact with you. But I've never, I mean, I don't know. Have you had people in person be nasty to you?
No, almost never. No,
exactly.
No, yeah, it's much harder to do in person.
Exactly. Yeah, I hear you.
And you know that says a lot about social media. I don't think we should get rid of social media. I think it's great, but you know, it's just there's always a downside to new technologies. These are just more problems to solve.
One or two more questions, then I'll let you go, and then we could start the weekend party. What are you doing this weekend, by the way, in the COVID
What am I
world?
doing? Well, I'm mostly playing with my kid and riding my bike, and really nothing different than what I
Than
normally
usually,
do.
yeah, I hear you.
Yeah.
By the way, for those of you who don't know, I visited Michael just before we were in the 300-year lockdown. It was just before it. And then we just squeezed back to Montreal, and then the lockdown happened. So thank you again for having hosted us in your beautiful home. You mentioned earlier Joe Rogan. I mean, I want to just go back very quickly to it. I think one of the things that I have found in doing my show, now, one of the wisdoms you hear about is that people don't have attentional span. They want to hear little snippets of 3-minute clips. Now, if I look at the analytics of my own show, almost all of the most viewed clips that I've had have been the conversations, the 1 hour, the 1.5 hours. And of course, we know from Joe Rogan, who's got the biggest audience in the world, he's got 3-hour shows. So the old wisdom of people don't have attentional spans and you can only give them 1-minute chunks is such bullshit. People are starving for these intimate, long format conversations, right?
I totally agree. Such a good sign that he's successful because it shows that the public is not as dumb as the mainstream
Exactly.
media thinks that they are. And I think maybe now they'll finally get it. You know, I mean, just the stories over the last year of like Elon Musk appeared on some podcast and said XXX. It's like some podcast. Dude, this guy's 20 times bigger than your newspaper, your TV show. Some
Well,
podcast.
I don't know if I have I don't know if I told you the story. Have I told you the story when I went to Stanford? Do you know that story with the Joe Rogan? I don't think so. Let me repeat it. Apologies to some of the viewers who might have heard me mention this before. So I was invited to Stanford Business School, which, you know, would be sort of one of the meccas of academia, where I was giving a talk on my, you know, evolutionary psychology, evolutionary consumer psychology stuff. And the host, the person who was taking me out to dinner, said, "Oh, you know, I hear you're going on Joe Rogan, or you've been on Joe Rogan, and so on." I said, "Oh yeah." He goes, "Yeah, you know, at Stanford, you know, we don't condone that. We don't." I said, "What do you mean? You don't condone what?" He goes, "Well, you know, we don't do research so that it could be sexy, so that we could talk about it on Joe Rogan." I said, "No. It's not an either or. It's not you either publish in peer-reviewed journals or you appear on Joe Rogan. You can do both. You could publish in top journals, and you could also try to excite 20 million people about the research that you do." And he was so haughty, he was so arrogant, this little Joe Rogan guy. I'm thinking, my God, man, you are denigrating it because you wish you could get on Joe Rogan, but you don't have the right personality to pull it off. You could exist in your little world where you've mastered the art of writing the template of the peer-reviewed paper. But when you have to go with a guy who is quick-witted and there are 20 million people watching you, you can't do it, therefore you're denigrated. What do you think?
That's a crazy story. Some of it, I think, is jealousy that they're either not doing it or they can't do it. A lot of academics think that, well, anybody could do what Neil deGrasse Tyson does.
Yeah.
No, actually, most people can't do that. He is
Exactly.
really good at what he does.
Yeah.
And I do a lot of TV media stuff, and when I see someone like Neil, I think that guy's better than me. Like when if I ride with Lance Armstrong, whoever, you know, it's like that guy's faster than me. He's a better cyclist than me. That's just the way it is. There's just we're not equal.
Yeah.
And Bill Nye, you know, again, another friend, and he's funny. It's hard to be funny,
Yeah.
you know, spontaneously funny, not telling jokes, but I mean, just responding in a way that's humorous. And of course, Carl Sagan was the model of public communication. And but a lot of academics and scientists think, well, that's just sort of dumbing down. Anybody could dumb down this science. He's not just dumbing down. It's clear communication. That's a
Exactly.
skill. That's
Well,
not easy to do.
listen, yesterday, I think I just mentioned that when I introduced you at the start of the show, I had Eric Topol on. I mean, Eric, I don't know if you know anything about him. I mean,
Yeah, I
this
had him
guy,
speak for me. Back in I don't know, 10 years ago at Caltech for his
I
first
mean,
book.
no one is going to question the scientific bona fide credentials of this guy. I mean, he's at the top of the top, and yet he is incredibly humble, incredibly down to earth. You couldn't imagine someone more humane, very good communicator. So the idea that, you know, you could only be a good academic if you're not a good teacher, or you're not a good communicator, or you don't appear on Joe Rogan, it's such a false dichotomy. It is pitting things that shouldn't be pitted against each other.
I consider it, think of it as a three-legged stool. You need data, theory, and communication.
Yeah.
You need all three, you know. So if you're just in the ivory tower cranking out data and theories and peer-reviewed papers, you're missing one of the legs. Your stool's going to fall
so
over.
So true.
You can't communicate it. And I don't mean dumbing down to the taxpayers because they pay our bills. That's not what I'm talking about.
Right.
I'm talking about explaining what the hell you're doing.
I hear you.
Because if the knowledge can't trickle down, if the theory can't be articulated to anybody, then what are you doing? What good is it, right?
So last question, then I'll let you go. And again, go out there and get a copy of this book, people.
Thanks.
What's your next book? If you're comfortable sharing, another book simmering in that
course,
head of yours?
I'm always cogitating, ruminating on the next big project. Well, one of my last Scientific American columns is called What is Truth Anyway? And so I'm thinking about a book along those lines, sort of integrating all of my work and then throwing in some epistemology, a theory of knowledge, you know, the different kinds of truths and, you know, all the postmodernism stuff and, you know, what the problems with that are in the context of, again, applying the scientific method and reason and rationality to political issues, economic, you know, religious, moral, meaning questions, because that's where the action is.
Got it. So
and
now I understand why you asked me the question about my position about Jordan Peterson's version of truth.
Yeah.
Okay, so maybe I'll need to go back and watch it so I can give you a proper answer. So what's the schedule on that book?
I don't know. I'm just still kind of outlining it in my head and talking to my agent, and you know, we're going to shop it around in a little while. No rush. I'm in life here in Santa Barbara.
Oh, very nice. Well, it's such a pleasure. Stay on the line so that we can say goodbye. It was so nice talking to you, and maybe have another one soon. Cheers, buddy. Stay on.